Welcome to another episode. My name's Jose Naharro, and today we're going to take a look at Facebook stock. So let's get started. Facebook just reported earnings after hours today, January 29th, 2020, and we can see things are not looking good in the range of the price. Right now, Facebook is down about 7%, negative $15, sitting at about $207. Like I said, the price might not be looking good, but let's take a look at the earnings to see if there's something hidden within this company. All right, so Facebook earnings per share beat by 3 cents, and revenue of $21.08 billion was a 24% year-to-year growth, and it beat by 180 million. So these values, it did beat, but it did beat by minimal value. So these are kind of pretty much flatline values to me. Next, let's take a look. Facebook did announce that they are increasing their buyback program. They're adding $10 billion more to their buyback authorization. And right now, this company had about $24 billion, and this $10 billion is going to go on top of that. And there is no expiration date to this buyback program. So this company has about $34 billion, and it did buy some companies, some shares back this year, and we'll take a look at them throughout the presentation. So the final thing I wanted to take a look at before moving into this presentation was I wanted to take a look at what the earnings per share estimates were for this company for next year. So for next year, this company is expected to make $9.38. And with the current price of $207, this gives the company a PE ratio of about 22.1 forward PE ratio, which is not that bad in my opinion. Usually tech companies I see around 25, I think is still okay for one to invest. So now let's take a look at what this company has in stock and let's see how it actually did. So first, we're going to take a look at their Facebook, at the presentation that they showed to the investors. And I just want to look at some of the slides here. We're not going to go through all the slides. There are some slides that I like that I think we should know more about. So those are the slides I'm going to talk about. The first slide I want to talk about is their Facebook average revenue per user. And right here, they divided in how their average revenue per users is distributed by region. And we can see one thing that I've noticed. I was taking a look at quarter four of 2018 compared to this quarter four of 2019. And for worldwide, average revenue used to be $7.25. For this quarter, it was $8.38. So we see an increase in average revenue per users. And we continue to see that increase in for US Canada, $34.09 up to $40.50 this quarter. In Europe, back then it was $10.82. This year was $12.99. In Asia Pacific, last year of quarter four was $2.94. This year was $3.55. And for the rest of the world, last year was $2.11. This year's quarter was $2.47. So we can see this company, right, in every part of the world is continuing to increase its average revenue per users. And that's definitely a strong thing to see. Another thing we can see is a huge, almost 99% of this company's revenue comes from advertising. The other comes from other, which is very minimal. The next slide I want to talk about is their family monthly active people. They call it MAP. And here they talk about all their platforms that they have. They have Instant Messenger, Instagram, Messenger, Facebook, WhatsApp. And they're tracking how much growth they're having within all these sectors, all these platforms. So not just by Facebook, because I don't think one should just take a look at Facebook, because this company is evolving to being more, it has evolved of being more than just a Facebook platform. It has different software, it has different types of companies. So we have to see outside of it. So I wanted to look at their family monthly, and they call it family because it includes all their other applications. So in quarter four of 2018, they had about 2.64 billion monthly active people. In quarter four of 2019, we saw an increase of 2.89 billion people. And we can see every quarter this year has continued to uptrend. So again, that's definitely a good thing for Facebook. Next, let's just take a quick look at the family average revenue per person. And we can see, right, average revenue per person this quarter was $7.38 compared to $6.52 same time last year. And look, seven out of that $7.38, $7.26 were advertising. The other is other. So you can see how strong advertising is for this company. The next slide I want to talk about is just their revenue. So revenue for this quarter was $21.1 billion. Same time last year was $16.9 billion. So a nice increase in revenue. And again, I just want to emphasize, look at this power of the company's advertising. Out of that $21.1 billion, $20.7 billion came from advertising. Next, I want to take a look at the revenue of Facebook by user geography. US and Canada make up about 50% of this company's total revenue, sitting at about $10.2 billion. The next biggest is Europe, which is about 25%, and the other 25% comes from Asia Pacific and the rest of the world. But we can see United States is a huge player. United States and Canada are both huge players for this company's revenue. And another thing we see is there is an uptrend of, there's everything continues to increase, right? US, Canada continues to increase. Europe revenue continues to increase. Asia Pacific continues to increase. And the rest of the world continues to increase revenue-wise quarter by quarter. So again, this definitely is looking good for Facebook. I think there's only two more slides I really wanted to take a look from their slides. And this is one that I think is super important. Operating margins. We're going to take a look in the spreadsheet that they gave us, that operating margins dropped down a lot this year. And we're here to see why. So this year, quarter three and quarter four were both above 41. They're still below what they were same time last year. So quarter one of last year was 42. Quarter three of this year was 41. Quarter four of last year was 46. Quarter four of this year was 42. So those, even though they are in their high four, in the 40s still, they are lower than the same time last year. Quarter one and quarter two are looking pretty bad at 22% in quarter one compared to 46% last year, and 27% in quarter two compared to 44% last year. But there were some legal expenses that happened during the first quarter of this year, the first and second quarter of this year. And they had a lot of expenses. So they had about $5 billion of expenses for quarter one and quarter two. And they did mention that if it wasn't for these expenses, quarter one of 2019 would actually be 20% higher, and quarter two of 2019 would be about 12% higher. So quarter one, if let's say we don't include that expense, quarter one would be 42%. But 42% is still lower than that 46% that they saw last year. And quarter two without the expense would be 39%, but that's still lower than that 44% last year. So every quarter, if we didn't have these expenses, this company would have definitely had above 40 annual gross margins, which would be good. But it would still be lower than same time last year, because every quarter of last year had higher gross margins than the quarters of this year. And that's something to definitely take note of. And the final slide I wanted to take a look at are just earnings per share. So again, due to those expenses that I just talked about, quarter one and quarter two had very weak earnings per share. Earnings per share, if we don't include those expenses, for quarter one would be $1.89, which would be a growth from same time last year of $1.69. And quarter two would be $1.99, which again would be a growth to same time last year, which was $1.74. So if it wasn't for those expenses, this company would definitely be making a lot more money. All right, so now let's jump into the spreadsheet that they gave us. So for the fourth quarter, we have fourth quarter and full year highlights from the company for 2019. So the first thing is we're going to see revenue for 2019 increased about 25% compared to 2018. For quarter four. So total revenue for quarter four was $21.1 billion. Quarter four for 2018 was $16.9 billion, which was a 25% increase. If we're taking a look at the year-to-year change, revenue grew by 27%. So a 27% growth is definitely that's definitely pretty strong numbers to see. This is anything in the double digits shows that this is still a growing company. Next, we're gonna see that total advertising, again, Twitter advertising was 20.7 out of that $21 billion, and it makes up a huge portion of this company's revenue. And advertising was up 25% in the quarter to quarter, and it was up 27% 2019 year end to 2018 year end. Next, we're going to talk about the main reason this company is supposedly down, and it's the total cost and expense. So total cost and expense for quarter four compared to quarter four of last year grew 34%. So 34, this is means that they're having 34% more increase in cost of revenue compared to a revenue growth of 25%. And remember, this quarter, it's definitely understandable if quarter one and quarter two had some low gross margins, but we can see that quarter three and quarter four have lower gross margins compared to the same time last year. And the reason is the total cost and expense for them to collect that revenue has increased. Year to year change, cost and expense grew 51% compared to 2018. And that is definitely a big number growth. Operating margins, like I said, for 2018, quarter four was 46%. And for 2019, quarter four was 42%. And like I said, it is because that huge increase in cost and expense. Next, let's take a look at net income. Net income for this year, for this quarter four of 2019, was $7.3 billion compared to 6 of quarter four of 2018, which was a 7% growth. Net income from for the full year of 2019 compared to the full year of 2018 actually decreased by 16%. And that's pretty crazy, right? Revenue for the year grew about $15 billion. So $15 billion more revenue this year compared to the same time last year. But this company still made less money this year than same time last year. Even if we add the $5 billion expense that this company had from the legal battles that it had in quarter one and quarter two, this company would only be about $23 billion. So not a huge increase in net income if we didn't count those charges. Earnings per share for this year was $6.43 for the full year of 2019, compared to $7.57 for the full year of 2018. And that's down 15%. And that's usually right in line with the net income. We talked about the family monthly active people, but they did see an increase of about 9% year over year. And we saw that chart continue to show an increase in active users for the company's total package. Cash and cash equivalents for this company is sitting at $54.86 billion. And that's what I like to hear. I like to see that a company has plenty of cash or cash equivalents ready to go. Headcount for this company grew about 26% year over year. And I think this is where the biggest cost is coming from. They have increased their amount of employees by 26% since same time last year. So now let's take a look at this company's income statement. So the first thing we're going to take a look is that growth in revenue. I already mentioned that, so let's screw that. Next, let's take a look at total cost of expense. So total cost and expense continue to grow, right? It was $15 billion more this year of 2019 compared to the full year of 2018, so a 50% growth. And we can see the biggest players here that made the biggest growth were general and administrative, increased by $7 billion. Last year was 3.5, this year was 7.5. So this is definitely has to do with the overall headcount increase that they're paying more people, so that headcount cost is going to be a lot higher. The other big one that I see is research and development. Research and development increased by about $3 billion. But for a growing company, that's okay with me. Seeing that research and development increase like that tells me that this company is focusing on continuing to develop their programs, their software, and everything that they have to offer. So that is always a great. I always like to see a company increase their research and development. Cost of revenue itself increased, but that's just because they had higher revenue this year. And marketing sales, they increased their marketing and sales by $2 billion. So that's probably, they probably hired more people for marketing and sales. But again, that's definitely a good thing because they want to cut more customers. So as long as these employees are getting more customers, then all to it. We already talked about net income. No point in mentioning that again. And we already talked about the diluted earnings per share. But now I want to take a look at the diluted number of shares this company has outstanding. So at the end of 2019, this company had about $2.9 billion shares outstanding. Right now it's sitting at 2.87 billion shares outstanding. So they did buy back a nice amount, about 50 million, I want to say about 50 million shares in the past year alone. So this company definitely has a strong buyback program. And as we saw in the previous article, this company has increased their buyback program for this year. Next, let's take a look at the balance sheet. This is my favorite thing that I want to take a look at. So at the end of December 31st, 2018, this company had $10 billion in cash and cash equivalents. Right now, this company has about $19 billion in cash and cash equivalents. So an increase of almost 100%. Marketable securities also increased. Last year was $31 billion. Right now, sitting at $35.8 billion. At the end of the day, total current assets grew about $16 billion. Those are great numbers to see. Next, we're going to take a look at this company's total assets. So total assets for this company grew about $30 billion. 15 of that $30 billion we saw came from total current assets. The other $10 billion came from property and equipment. It seems that they have some new plants or facilities going on that increased about $10 billion. And the other $10 billion came from operating lease and right of use nets. So this is something new that most companies have to include now in their asset, in their balance sheet, is just whatever they're leasing can count as an asset and a liability. And that was a $10 billion increase compared to almost nothing same time last year. So total assets pretty much were about $123 billion this year compared to $97 billion last year. If we're taking a look at apples to apples, right, let's take away this operating lease because it was not there last year. So about a $25 billion increase in total assets is still a really good thing, especially when 15 of that comes from total current assets, which is pretty much just cash ready to go. Next, let's take a look at this company's liability. Total current liabilities grew about $8 billion this year. And the main reason was just accrued expenses and other current liabilities grew about that $7 billion that total current liabilities grew at. Again, this is not a big issue, especially with the amount of cash this company has shown it grew in 1 year. So it's not something I would be completely going crazy about. Total liabilities grew about $20 billion. That's a huge amount. But we can see, right, that same thing I talked about in the current assets, about $9.5 billion of that total liabilities is just something that they had to include this year that they didn't include last year. So at the end of the day, total liabilities grew by about $12 billion instead of about $20 billion. And total assets still grew about $23 billion. So the amount of assets growing is faster than the amount of total liabilities growing, which to me is definitely a great thing to see. So we're almost done. The next thing we want to take a look at is this company's cash flow statement. And net cash flow provided by operating activities is the one I care about the most because this is the amount of cash they make from their everyday use. At the end of this year, they had an operating cash flow of $36 billion positive compared to $29 billion last year, which again, those are great numbers to continue to see a growth. That's actually a growth of almost 20% in net cash flow. Actually, it is 20% growth. And then repurchase of common stock. Last year, this company bought a lot of stock. Last year, this company bought about 13 billion shares. In 2018, when the prices were pretty cheap. This year, this company bought about 4.2 billion shares, which is still a heavy amount, and they're gonna continue to buy. So that's it. That's all I got for Facebook, guys. Let me know what you guys think. I honestly think this is a good company, but these earnings episodes that I'm doing right now, I'm just taking a quick look at the overall picture. Right now, I'm writing down company names that I'm gonna do a more in-depth analysis of. And Facebook, after taking a look and seeing that drop down, is definitely a company I would want to take a look furthermore. Like I said, right now Facebook is definitely looking good. They have a good balance sheet. I really like their balance sheet. Their income statement is not looking too bad. It does suck that they have an increase in cost of revenue by almost 50%, but we can see that their margins aren't as low as they are shown to be, because their gross margins took a big hit from quarter one and quarter two of this year due to those legal fights. So we can see, right, their gross margins did decrease, but their revenue continues to increase at a faster rate. They have a great income statement sheet. They have a great balance sheet and the amount of cash flow they have. And this company is also buying back shares. But yeah, this company is definitely looking pretty good for now. And like I mentioned, I'm going to write this down and do a further analysis on this company later after earnings season is done. So take care, guys. Have a good night and see you next time.